हेलो, प्लीज टेल अदर्स टू जॉइन फर्स्ट. ओके. सो आई विल शेयर माय स्क्रीन नाउ. Can you see the screen? Can you see the screen? Okay, Ashwin. Okay, Anurag. Okay. So where did we stop last class? I think we were discussing about Cartesian product, isn't it? Isn't it? I think you had written down Cartesian product of two sets. Hello, can you hear me? See, given two sets A and B, where A is equal to 1, 2 and B is equal to ABC, the Cartesian product of two sets is denoted by A cross B, isn't it? And A cross B is equal to, it is a set. A cross B is a set which consists of elements, ordered pairs, which belong, where the first element belongs to A and the second element belongs to B. So you should take all possible combinations of A cross B. That is, now from A you have 1A, 1B, 1C, and the next element 2. It is you can have the ordered pairs 2A, 2B, 2C. So suppose if there are two elements in A. Suppose you have two elements in A, and if there are two elements in A, and if there are three elements in B, then A cross B will have how many elements? 3 into 2 elements, and that is equal to 6 elements. Okay, if A has two elements and B has three elements, then A cross B, that is this set A cross B, will have 6 elements. Just count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So total 6 ordered pairs will be there in A cross B. Is it clear? So if we generalize it, if A has m elements and B has n elements, then A cross B will have m and m into n elements. Okay, just write it down somewhere. If the set A has m elements and set B has n elements, then A cross B will have m into n elements. I think you had written it down in the last class. Isn't it? Suppose A has n elements, then A cross B contains n square elements. Did you write it down? Did you write it down in the last class? Hello? Someone please respond. Well, where did you write in the last class? Where did you write in the last class? Nainika, unmute and answer. Where did you write? Where did you stop writing in the last class? Nainika is not there. Punya? Rajat?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Nainika. Where did, what is the last sentence that you had written in the last class?
Suppose that A is equal to 1 to find A square and A cube.
What? If A is equal to?
1 to in brackets.
1 to?
Curly brackets.
Okay. Yes, the A is a set. You can call if set A is equal to 1, 2, 3, in curly brackets means it is a set, isn't it? So if A is equal to 1, 2, 3, then
find A square and A cube.
Find A square and A cube. Okay, did you find it? Did you find A square and A cube? How will you find A square? What is A square? A square is A cross A, isn't it? What was the question given? Just tell me the question. A is equal to 1, 2, 3 or 1, 2?
1, 2.
Okay, okay. If A is equal to 1, 2, find A square and A cube. This was the question given, isn't it? Isn't it?
Yes,
did anyone do that? Okay, so how will we do A cross A square? What is A square? A square is nothing but A cross A. Now, A cross A is the set which consists of ordered pairs from A to A itself. So you have the next set is also A. First set is A, the second set is also A. And so A cross A. So A cross A will have elements from A to A itself, and that is the ordered pairs 1, 1, 1, 2, isn't it? Then next element is 2, 1, 2, 2. Okay, so how many elements are there? If A has two elements, isn't it? So A cross A will have 2 into 2 elements, and that is equal to total, there will be 4 elements. So these are the elements, that is 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1 and 2, 2. Because the next element A is also 1, 2. So you have to take all possible ordered pairs from A to A. So we have to take 1, 1, then 1, 2, then next element 2, 1 and 2, 2. So all these form an ordered pair, and the total number of ordered pairs will be equal to 4, since A has only two elements. A cross A will have 2 into 2 elements, and that is equal to 4 elements. Is it clear? Is it clear to you? Any doubt? So did you get, did you write down A cross A? Did you write down A cross A? Write it in your notebook. If you haven't written it, then write it down. Rajat, did you write it? Rajat, Sahila, Noora, did you write it? See, why no response from your side? Are you listening or what? Are you there? Shahana Sharan, did you write that answer, A cross A? I've solved it now, isn't it? Shanil. Now, how you find out A cross, how will you find out A cube? What is A cube? What is A cube? A cube is A cross A, isn't it? So you have to take all possible ordered pairs, and these ordered pairs will have elements. The first element belongs to first A. The second element belongs to second A, the third element belongs to third A. Likewise, it goes on. Since A is equal to 1, the set 1, 2, you have A cross A, cross A means you have to take all pairs from A, three times. You have to take all possible ordered pairs from A to A to A. So, and this is first first element. Next, you will have 1, 1, 2. Next, you have 1, 1, 2, 1. Then 1, 2, 2. Likewise, it goes on. So how many elements will be there in A cross A cross A? How many elements will be there in A cube? Can anyone say how many elements will be there in A cube? Hello? How many elements will be there? Yes, two cube elements. Since there are two elements in A and it is done three times, we are doing it three times, so there will be two cube elements. So that is 2 raised to 2. Okay, that is equal to 8. Very good. So there will be 8 elements, and you have to write down all these. And this one, if there are only 2 elements, we can call it as an ordered pair, since a pair has only 2 elements. Now, if there are more than 2 elements, then we call this. Here we have 3 elements in that pair. And it is not a pair. We call it as an ordered tuple. Ordered tuple. T-U-P-L-E, or tuple or tuple, any way you can pronounce. So if there are more than 2, if there are only 2 elements, we call it as an ordered pair. But if there are more than 2 elements, if there are only 2 elements, we call it as an ordered pair. Ordered pair. And but if there are more than 2 elements, like if there are 3 sets, 3 or more sets, then it forms an ordered tuple or an ordered tuple. So the first element belongs to first set, second element belongs to the second set, and the third element belongs to the third set. These are the 3 sets. Here only thing is, all the 3 sets are A. Is it clear? So write down A cross A or A cube in your notebook. Now, that is about cross product. Anyway, we will be using it in our in the next sections and all. Now, let us come to the next section, set identities. Okay. Set identities. Write the heading in your notebook as set identities. So, in this, the first one is the identity law. The first one is the identity law. Just like we had studied certain laws in logic, propositional logic and predicate logic, here also in set theory also we are applying the same laws, and mostly the same names are also used. But here, instead of propositional variables, here we have set. Each of them represents set. So around 10 laws we have to study here also. So the first one is the identity law. Okay, so write down the heading set identities, and then first law is the set identity law. Did you write down? So identity law. According to identity law, if you have a set A, then A intersection universal set. This represents universal set. This is the universal set. Okay. That represents universal set. It is a universal set. U is the universal set. So this says that when we draw the Venn diagram, here inside you have set A, and this is the universal set, and A intersection universal. Universal set is the whole thing, including A. And A is only this much portion. So intersection of A and universal set is this part, and that is equal to the set A itself. So A intersection universal set is set A. That is identity law, the first identity law. And the second identity law says that A union universal set, A union null set. M null set means empty set. A along with the null set, it forms set A itself. It is not taking universal set into account. So A union null set is equal to the set A. Okay. Is it clear? So identity law states that A intersection universal set is equal to A, and A union null set is A itself. So here, just see that intersection has become union and universal set has become null set. So the dual of union is intersection, and the dual of intersection is union, and the dual of the universal set is null set, and dual of null is universal set. Likewise, it goes back also. Okay, so in set theory, when we consider duals, the dual of intersection is union, and dual of union is intersection, and dual of the universal set is null set. So when we look at identity law, just taking the dual of the first one, you get the second law. Identity law, first law is A intersection universal set is equal to A. So in second, to get the second law, just take the dual, that is dual of intersection is union, dual of universal set is null set. So just change the union to intersection and universal set to null set, you will get the second identity law, that is A union null set is equal to A. Is it clear? So that is identity law. So did you write down the heading as set identities? Are you writing it down? Hello? Are you writing down these laws? Vignesh, did you write down the laws? Hello, Saurabh. I'm not getting any response. Okay, so write down the law in your notebook. I'll be checking your notebook tomorrow. So set identities and write first law, identity law. Now let us go on to the second law. That is, second law is domination law. According to domination law, A union universal set is equal to universal set. That is, you have set, this is the universal set and this is set A. A union universal set means this is set A, and if you are taking the union of A and universal set, then you get the entire universal set. That is, A union universal set is equal to the universal set. Okay, then A intersection null set is equal to null set. Okay, so this is domination law. And here also we have changed in union to intersection and universal set to null set. Here also universal set is changed to null set. So just by taking the dual of first law, you get the second law. Okay, so the domination law states that A union universal set is universal set, A intersection null set is null set. So next, third law. So write down the second law, domination law. Next, the third law is called idempotent law. Third law is idempotent law. And we had learned this idempotent law before also. That is, P intersection P is equal to P, P union, P or P is equal to P. Isn't it? We had learned this idempotent law before also. So likewise here also, A union A is equal to A and A intersection A is equal to A, and this law is called idempotent law. A union A is equal to A and A intersection A is also equal to A. We call this law as idempotent law. In propositional logic also we had studied the same law, but there we studied with propositions, that is conjunction B and P is equal to P and P or P is equal to P. The same idempotent law is applied here also. Instead of and, we have intersection, and or, we have union here. So that is the third law. Then, so write down the third law. Next, going on to the fourth law, complementation law. Okay, next is complementation law. And complementation law we had studied in propositional logic also, isn't it? Not of not P. What is not of not P? What is not of not P? What is not of not P? P. Very good, Agash. Not of not P. Negation of negation. The negation gets cancelled. You get P itself. So here also we have complementation law, that is complement of a set. A complement, the whole complement is equal to A. That is, A complement, the whole complement is equal to A. So in set theory, we represent a negation of a set as a bar A with a bar on top. So this is A complement. And again, once more, if you are taking the complement, you put one more bar. Again, if you are taking a complement three times, then one more bar. If you are taking four times, again, you put one more bar. So this goes on. So A complement, the whole complement, A complement, the whole complement is equal to A. Okay, that is called complementation law. Then, next law. So write it down, write the fourth law, complementation law. Then, next is commutative law. Now, what is commutative law? You had studied commutative law, associative law, etc. All these laws are applied here also. That is, A union B is equal to B union A, and A intersection B is equal to B intersection A. That is called commutative law. In propositional logic, you studied P and Q is equal to Q and P, or P or Q is equal to Q or P. So by changing the order, there is no change in the truth values. So likewise, in set theory also, we have A union B is equal to B union A, and A intersection B is equal to B intersection A. You cut class, you can. So that is complementation law. That is, A union B is equal to B union A, and A intersection B is equal to B intersection A. So did you write down the complementation law? Please write down these laws, okay? Then the sixth law is associative law. You know associative law. We had studied in propositional logic also. That is, A union B union C is equal to A union B union C. So you can take union with any, either you can take A union B first and then take the union of C, or you can take B union C first and then take the union with A. So that law is known as associative law. We had studied in propositional logic like this, isn't it? P and Q and R is equal to P and Q and R, isn't it? Likewise for R, we had studied P or Q or R is equal to P or Q or R. So this is associative law in propositional logic. The same can be applied to set theory also. And in set theory, we take two sets A and B, and then we write A union. Instead of A, or you have union here, intersection, instead of intersection, we have conjunction, we have intersection here. So A union B union C is equal to A union B union C. And also A intersection B intersection C is equal to A intersection B intersection C. So the order, you can change the order in associative law. Then, next is distributive law. Distributive law. Now what is distributive law? You know the distributive law also. When you have union and intersection coming together, we have A union B intersection C is equal to A union B intersection A union C. And that this is a distribution of union over intersection. And also A intersection B union C is equal to A intersection B union A intersection C. Okay, so this one will, the middle union, or whether it is union or intersection, union or intersection, it will come in the middle here. And it is distributed over the outer one. Okay, so A union B intersection C is equal to A union B intersection A union C, and A intersection B union C is the same as A intersection B union A intersection C. So that is distributive law. You had studied and you had written the exam also, so you hope you know what is distributive law. Next is De Morgan's law. Okay, what is De Morgan's law? In propositional logic, we studied like this: P and Q, the whole not of P and Q, isn't it? Not of P and Q is equal to not P or not Q. It's the same thing is applied here also. A intersection B, instead of here the negation is written as complement, the whole complement is equal to A complement union B complement. So the A complement is nothing but negation, and B complement is negation of B. So you get A complement union B complement. This is De Morgan's law. And also A union B the whole complement is equal to A complement intersection B complement. You just split it into two and take, if it is union here, put intersection. And when you split it, you get A bar and B bar. So that is De Morgan's law. So did you write down all these laws? Hello? Are you writing down these laws? Kiran? Did you write down all those laws till De Morgan's law? Did you write? Okay. So the next law. Absorption law. And in propositional logic also we studied absorption law. So what is absorption law? See, A union A intersection B. So A is repeated twice. And if we have union here, there should be intersection inside. So in that case, we can apply absorption law. And according to absorption law, A union A intersection B is equal to A. The variable that is repeated will come here. And A intersection A union B is also equal to A. Okay, if you expand it and apply distributive law, you will finally reach A. So anyway, this law is called absorption law. That is A union A intersection B is A, and A intersection A union B is also A. So here, just note that if A is repeated twice and if the outer one is union and the inner one is intersection, then you can apply absorption law. Then, so write down the law, absorption law. Then next is complement law. According to complement law, A union A complement is equal to universal set. Now, even if you draw the Venn diagram, you will be able to find out all these laws. This is A. This is universal set. A union A complement. A complement is everything outside A. This is A complement. And this is A. So A union A complement means the entire thing, and that is the entire thing is universal set. So A union A complement is equal to universal set. And A intersection A complement. A complement is everything outside A. And only this portion is A. Now intersection of these two, there is nothing in this common to these two areas. So A intersection A complement is equal to null set. So that is called complement law. That is A union A complement is universal set and A intersection A complement is null set. Here also, if we apply the dual to first one, you will get the second. If you take the dual of first law, you will get the second one. So these are the 10 laws that we come across in set theory. Okay. Is it clear? Did you write down all these laws? Did you write down the laws? Sahala, did you write down the laws? Malavika? Nandana? Hello? Typhil, did you write down all these 10 laws? Okay. So now let us move on to the next part. So these laws which you had studied earlier, you just applied the same method here also. Whatever you had studied in propositional logic, instead of and or, you have union and intersection here. So now let us move on to the next one, next section. Membership table. Now, what is membership table? This membership table is just like the truth table in propositional logic. Instead of truth table, in set theory, we use membership table. So to represent set identities, to prove set identities, we use membership table. So use membership. Now let us see one example. Use membership table to show that A intersection B union C is equal to A intersection B union A intersection C. So this law we had studied earlier. Which law is this? What is the name of this law? A intersection B union C is equal to A intersection B union A intersection C. What is the name of that law? Anyone? What is the name of that law? A intersection B union C is equal to A intersection B union A intersection C. What is the name of that law? Distributive law. Very good, Nivedita. Very good, Agash. It is distributive law. So we have to prove that they are equal. And to prove that they are equal in set theory, we use membership table. In propositional logic, we use truth table, but here we are using membership table. And what is membership table? See, look at this. I have to prove this. So write down this question. First, you write down membership table. Heading as membership table. And then you write, below that you write, set identities can be proved using membership table. Write the heading as membership table. And below that you write, set identities can be proved using membership table. And then write this example. Use membership table to show that. Use membership table to show that. A intersection B union C is equal to A intersection B union A intersection C. So just like you are going to write or draw a truth table, we have to find out each element in this formula. That is, A is one set, B is another set, C is another set. So we have three sets here. So you have to write down all the three sets first. Just like in propositional logic, you write down the propositional variables. Here also, we have to find out how many sets are involved in this formula, and then we have to write down the sets in each column. So the first column you have to write A, second column B, third column C. Since there are three sets in this formula, you have to write down the three sets first. Okay, then you have to write down the operations, set operations. The first operation that you have to compute is B union C. Only if you get B union C, then you can take its intersection with A. So the next one is B union C. Then you can take, if once B union C is found out, then you can take intersection with A. So that is, next column will be A intersection B union C. So what we have to prove is this RHS is equal to this. This LHS, this is LHS. Okay, this LHS is equal to RHS. Left hand side is equal to right hand side. So we have computed this side first. Next we have to compute the RHS. So to compute RHS, we have to find out A intersection B. So that is here, A intersection B, and then we have to find out A intersection C, and then take the union A intersection B union A intersection C. Okay, so now we have our aim is to prove that this side is equal to this side. That is, the LHS is equal to RHS. LHS is this and RHS is this. If they are equal, then we can say that our set, our distributed law is true. Okay, so ABC, since there are three sets, you have to write ABC, and then you compute each, to compute each side, this side, to compute the LHS, you have to first compute B union C. And then once you get B union C, you can take its intersection with A, and so the LHS gets completed. And then to compute the RHS, you have to first compute A intersection B, then you compute A intersection C, and then take the union of both, and that forms the RHS. And then show that both the columns are the same. Did you understand what I said? Is it clear to you? Hello? Any doubt? Any doubt? Did you understand how I am filling that membership table? Shira, okay, yes. So just write down the sets that are involved. Just like in propositional logic, if there are three variables, we write down all these three variables and then find out the operations one by one. Just like we are doing truth table, here also we are doing the membership table using set. Okay. Now, here also, we have three variables, so you have to write all possible combinations of zeros and ones. So the first one will be, I have told you one easy method, isn't it? The last column, A, B, C, in C you can put 0, 1, 0, 1 alternatively. In B you can put two zeros, two ones in that sequence. And in the first column, that is the A column, you can put four zeros. That is, in powers of two, you can put these zeros. So, and some students, I find that they didn't even fill this column, okay, for your exam. Now, next you have to find B union C. B union C means taking B and C. B union C, just like you are doing your propositional logic, here also 0 and 0, union is 0, 0, 1. Either a union means either B should be 1 or C should be 1 or both B and C should be 1. Just like this OR operation in propositional logic, we are using the union operation in set. So when you find out B union C, we can see that 0 and 0, 0 union 0, 0, 0, 1, you get 1. If there is at least 1, the output will be 1. So at least 1 means if both 1s are there, the output will be 1. Both are 0, output is 0. So here also we have 1, so output is 1. Here you have 1, so output is 1. You have both 1, so output is 1. This is how you compute B union C. Next, A intersection B union C. That is, take this column, first column A, and A and this column B union C, and take the intersection, that is the AND operation. AND operation means if both are 1, the output is 1. Otherwise, it is 0. So, first case, all these cases, it is 0. And in this case, both are 1. In the last three columns, you have A is 1, B union C is 1, so output is 1. Here also, we have both 1, so output is 1. Here also, both are 1, so output is 1. So likewise, you have to compute the other side also. Now we have computed the LHS. To compute RHS, you have to first find out A intersection B, that is take the intersection of A and B, and if both are 1, output is 1, and that case happens only in these two rows. So output is 1. And A intersection C means take the intersection of A and C, and if both are 1, output is 1, happens only in this column. Okay. Now next, to compute the RHS, you take the union of these two columns. So when you take the union, if any one of them is 1, the output is 1. So the last three columns you will get 1. Since here we have both 1, here also you will get 1. So now compare these two. This is RHS and this is LHS. When we compare these two, we find that both the columns have the same truth values. If they have the same truth values, then we can say that these two are equal. Okay. Is it clear? If they have the same truth values, then we can say that the two columns are equal. That is, A intersection B union A intersection B union C is equal to A intersection B union A intersection C. Likewise, you can prove all those set identities. All set identities can be proved using membership table. Okay. Is it clear? Did you write down the table? Did you write down the membership table? And did you get those two columns equal? Did you write down those membership table? Siddharth, did you draw that table? Did you draw that table? Friraj. Did you draw that table? So did you get those two columns equal? Are those two columns equal? Okay, that will prove, hence we can prove that distributive law is true, isn't it? We have proved distributive law. Okay. So that is about membership table. So instead of truth table, in set theory we use membership table to prove set identities. Now we had certain formulas there. All these certain formulas can be proved using membership table. Is it clear? So now let us move on to the next part, relations. So give the heading as relations. So this is what the next section of set theory. So here we discuss relationship between two sets. Okay, relationship between two sets. Now we have till now we were speaking about two sets that are independent of each other, but now we are going to discuss about how two sets can be related to each other and what are the different relationships that hold. So relationship between two sets, they are represented using structures called binary relations. Now binary means two, that is if there are two sets then we call it as binary relation. So relationship between two sets is called binary relation. So it is, and usually this binary relation is a subset of the Cartesian product of the set. So if we have two sets A and B, if you have two sets A and B, if we are taking A cross B, you get it is a set of ordered pairs in A and B, isn't it? And this relation between the two sets is a set of ordered pairs. The relation between two sets is a set of ordered pairs that satisfies the relation. So here we are going to find out how, what are the relationships and how are we going to derive these relationships, etc. So here ordered pairs are used to express the relationship between two sets. Since we are if we are expressing relationship as in the form of A cross B, you get ordered pairs, you get a set of ordered pairs in A cross B, and with, and from the ordered set, ordered pairs, we get a subset that satisfies the relation, and that subset forms the relationship between A and B. When we do examples, you will be able to understand what it is. So ordered pairs are used to express relationship between two sets. Now ordered pairs we come across in cross product only. So if we have two sets A and B, take the cross product of the two sets, and the set of ordered pairs obtained will form a relation from A to B. And since there are two sets involved, we call it as binary relations. Then here the exact definition is like this, that is, if A and B are two sets, we have two sets A and B, then what is a binary relation? A binary relation from A to B is a subset of A cross B. That is, in A cross B we can have, suppose if A has m elements and B has n elements, then A cross B will have mn elements, and the relation from A to B can be a subset of mn. That is, all the ordered pairs need not come in this relation R. It is a subset of A cross B. The relation R is a subset of A cross B. Now we will be doing examples and you will be able to understand what it is. So if A and B are two sets, then the binary relation from A to B is a subset of A cross B, and it is denoted by, that binary relation is denoted by the set R of ordered pairs. You know, it is a set of ordered pairs since it belongs to A cross B. So it is a set of ordered pairs. Now, in that ordered pair, the first element of each ordered pair comes from... Hello?
Teacher, time I learn.
ഒന്നും പത്ത് വരല്ലേ, വൺ വരെയാണ് അല്ലേ? ആ ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ. ഓക്കെ, അപ്പൊ ഇത്രയും നിങ്ങൾ നോക്കി വെച്ചേക്കുക കേട്ടോ. ഐ ബി അപ്ലോഡിംഗ് നോട്ട്സ് ഇൻ ലിങ്ക് വേസ്. ഇത് ആരാ പറഞ്ഞത്? Okay. Okay, okay, Abhiram, okay. 1 o'clock, where are you? Okay.